Welcome to the Palace of Praise. We're so glad you joined us for worship and the Word. I'm Cindy.
I'm Mindy. This is happening now. We invite you to take a look at the exciting opportunities available to help you stay informed and get connected.
Summer is an exciting time for the Palace Kids Ministry. To kick things off, they're hosting a golf tournament on Saturday, April 13th at Ozark Ridge Golf Course. Proceeds from the tournament will go towards Kids Camp 2019. It's a four-person scramble tournament. The cost is $50 per person. You can get your team signed up at the Ministry Center in the foyer. For more information, contact Junior Law or Pastor Mike at mike@palaceofpraise.com.
Kids Camp 2019 is right around the corner. Pastor Mike invites all parents of kids in kindergarten through sixth grade to a very important meeting on Sunday, April 14th, following the morning service. This meeting will cover camp applications, cost, facts, and most importantly, fundraisers. The first fundraiser will start that day. Please make plans to attend this meeting.
On Saturday, April 20th at Whiteley Park, the Evangelism Task Force and Palace Kids will host the first outreach of the year. The Community Easter Egg Hunt is a fun favorite with all kids. There will be three different hunts for ages 0 to 3, 4 to 6, and 7 to 10. It all starts at 10:30 at Whiteley Park. Invite your neighbors, your family, and friends.
We will have a baby dedication on Sunday, April 28th in the PM service. To register your baby, call Terry Font at 785-4232 or register on the church app.
On Wednesday, April 17th, the entire Palace of Praise family will gather in the main sanctuary for a special The Glories of the Cross service. We'll use this time of worship, reflection, and the Word to examine the importance of the cross. Plan to join us and bring an offering to the Lord.
It's time for a Palace of Praise family and friends movie night. We will be watching Breakthrough, a movie based on the miraculous true story of a St. Louis teenager and the power of prayer and the Holy Spirit. Watch the trailer now.
Rise and shine. Breakfast is ready in 10 minutes. And don't make me come back up there.
This is our town. It's a close-knit community, the kind of place where everyone knows everyone.
Hi, Miss Jay.
Hey, how are you girls?
And we're always there for each other.
Nice sermon, Pastor.
What do you guys have on for the rest of the day?
Well, John has a basketball game.
Yeah, I've seen this guy hoop it up around here. This kid is so lit.
Text your mom tomorrow and tell her when and where to pick you up.
And, don't do anything stupid.
Love you guys.
Boys, get off the ice!
We're training for the Olympics, sir!
Cindy!
John!
He's been underwater for more than 15 minutes. It's gonna be a recovery, not a rescue.
I got something.
We got him!
We've done everything medically possible. There's nothing more we can do.
Please, God, send your Holy Spirit to save my son.
A 14-year-old St. Charles boy who spent 15 minutes trapped underwater is continuing to fight for his life.
I don't believe John will survive the night.
You don't know my son. He is a fighter, so I need you to be the best for John, and you just let God do the rest. You are my pride and joy. I can't wait to see you shoot those baskets and run up and down the court again.
The Smith family asked for one thing. Please pray for John.
In the water that day,
I was ready to give up, but then I hear this voice telling me, go back.
Either I'm nuts
or God's talking to you.
But I don't believe in God.
I believe, but maybe that only goes so far with something like this.
I'm your pastor. I'm supposed to walk alongside you for as long as it takes.
Did you see the Facebook page? It's gone viral.
Tommy?
I hope he's gonna be okay.
We're not gonna get through this alone. Whatever you have for me, from Brian, from John,
movie night will be on Thursday, April 18th at 7 p.m. at the Poplar Bluff 8 AMC Theater. Tickets are available at the Ministry Center in the foyer. Tickets are $6.
Ben and Kimberly Henson invite you to join them for a four-week series on handling money using biblical principles. The series will begin on Sunday, May 5th at 9:30 a.m. You can register for the class at the Ministry Center in the foyer.
For ladies who love to read and enjoy insightful discussion, Chapter Chat will meet at Costello's on Monday, April 29th at 5:30 p.m. They will be discussing The Witness by Dee Henderson.
Summer softball season is almost here. If you're interested in playing on the Palace of Praise team, sign up at the Ministry Center. Contact Charlie Richardson for more information. That's it for this week. Stay up to date on current and future events by following us on social media or by visiting our website at palaceofpraise.com. I'm Cindy.
And I'm Mindy. Thanks for watching. This has been Happening Now. Find your ministry and go get connected.
Lord, I give you thanks. God, I give you grace. life. Hallelujah.
Come on, you can do better than that. Let's give him praise tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you and hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praises. Oh, hear the sound of hearts returning to you. Return to you. In your kingdom, when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praises. Hosanna. Come out your way, oh.
The same God who never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. He's working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Yes, I will. God who's never fails, fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. He's working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against. And nothing can stand against. I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. And nothing can stand against. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will. Come on, just lift your hands tonight and sing. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. And yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. Come on, just bless his name tonight. Yes, I will.
That's the word that the Lord's looking for. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Looked like the men took a long nap this afternoon. But you're here, and that's what matters. Lord said, where two or three are gathered together, I'll be right there. Father, we thank you for your goodness, mercy, and your grace, for your love is everlasting. You're always there, Lord, waiting for that cry. And we say, yes, Lord. Father, meet the needs of your people tonight. Bless this offering in Christ's name. Amen.
And I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names. And nothing can stand against. I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names. Oh, nothing can stand against. I choose to praise.
Praise the Lord. It's good to see y'all here tonight. We're short a few tonight, but that's okay. The Lord is with us. Amen? Amen. I thought about having Zach cut the PA cord again like he did last time, so I'd get y'all suited up a little closer to me so you could hear me. Thanks, Zach. Appreciate that. But anyway, I want to get right into the word of the Lord tonight. We'll begin by doing our declaration. If you would please stand. Here we go. Lord, today by faith, we declare that we are walking in the manifestation season. As your faithful remnant, we will house your very presence. We are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, and he has delivered us from all of our troubles and fears. We are no longer victims, but we are victors in Christ. We will not be deceived by the lies of the enemy, but we will give health, healing, and wholeness to the hopeless and those in despair. We live under your anointing and see the revealed purpose of Christ in each of our lives. We declare your everlasting word on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Give God praise. Remain standing, please. I'm going to ask Brother Marvin if he would pray over tonight's message, please. Amen. You may be seated. I don't plan to keep you long tonight. See how that works. Okay. I first want to share, before I get into my actual scripture, 2 Timothy 3:16, which says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, reproof, and instruction in righteousness. And I believe tonight's message is one of instructions. And for some, maybe it's a moment of correction. I feel it's a word of sound biblical advice, though, to those who are desiring to live as a believer, but find themselves at times struggling to do so. And I want to begin by prefacing a question to you. Could it be your surroundings and the people you surround yourself with be contributing to being a big part of your struggles? Have you ever considered that could be an underlying contributor? In other words, to put it simple, could it be you're hanging out in the wrong places with the wrong people? So let me begin here in giving some instructive scripture to you, some wisdom for you to consider. Found in Proverbs 13 and 20, I'll read it from the New King James Version. It says, "He that walks with wise men will be wise, but the companion of fools will be destroyed." Now tonight, I'm going to be teaching on a topical subject that can affect every single one of our lives with no exception. Can really bring struggle to trying to live righteous. Proverbs 13, verse 20, I want to read it one more time so you get this clearly. "He that walks with wise men will be wise, but the companion of fools will be destroyed." Meaning those who hang out with fools will watch their life fall to pieces, be destroyed. What I would like you to understand tonight is you never are just hanging out. But there's a lot more going on than you realize between you and the people that you surround your life with. You see, life is like a chain. And every single one of us is connected to someone. You see, when you're born, you become connected to someone. And all these prior links in this chain represent great-great-grandpa and great-grandpa and grandpa and mom and dad and brothers and sisters and friends and teachers and pastors and coaches and all kinds of people in your life that throughout your life you became connected to once you were born and your life began. But here's what you must understand. In the chain of your life, there's always an invisible flow going on. There is a current from the other people that you are connected to in your life. Now, this current not only comes to you, it passes through you to others. This is how life operates, and this is how life starts for you, and it's how life continues to be. And that invisible flow that I'm talking about is called influence. And anytime two people connect, influence takes place, either positive or negative. Impacting your life as well as others, it impacts your home, it impacts your children, it impacts your career, it impacts your friends. There's a flow in, and there's also a flow out. People you are connected to are either going to influence you negatively or positively. Some will add to your life, some will subtract. Some enhance your life, but some will shut you down. Some make you better, but some make you bitter. Some strengthen your faith, and some will weaken your faith. Some will encourage you, and some people will discourage you. And you got to understand, as you hang out in your life, that there is friends and there's adversaries. There's people for you, and there's people against you. There's partners, and there's predators. There's teammates, and there's opponents. There's embalmers, and there's anointers. There's always two opposite forces. And Jesus said it this way, "You're either for me or you're against me." See, there's a lot of people out there to possibly connect to and hang out with, but it's never as innocent as it appears. Anybody know anybody who started hanging out with someone new and it changed them for the worst? It changed their attitude. It had changed their appearance. It changed their outlook on life. Have you ever heard it said, "He used to be a great guy until he started hanging out with that guy"? Have you heard, "He used to come to church all the time till he got mixed up with that girl"? Or, "She's all right to be around as long as she's not hanging around with Susie, because when she's hanging around with Susie, she's a total snob and she's totally different." What makes him or her act differently is negativity. The influence of the one he or she is hanging out with. Ever seen someone hang out with a new crowd and it makes them better? That happens too. Ever found yourself saying, ever since she got rid of that joker, she's so much more fun to be around. She's so much more happier now. Or have you ever heard it said, once he got involved with that group, he excels in his studies now. Man, that teacher really made a difference in his life. Man, since he's been going to that youth group, he's not the same kid. Why? Because the influence is positive. Influence is powerful, and it's often underestimated. Want to change your life? Let me tell you, change your influences. That sounds too simple to many, but it sounds too hard for others. Truth is, there are some people who spend their whole life covered in contamination of past relationships. They hung out with people who had issues, seeing no harm in it at first, and now they got some of the same issues. They didn't do drugs, but now they're addicted. They weren't critical, but now they're critical. They weren't analytical, but now they're analytical. They didn't cheat, now they're a cheater. They didn't steal, but now they're stealing. They weren't lazy, but now they won't work half the time. Somebody else's stuff got on you, and guess what happens now? You're going to pass it on through the chain. It came to you, you connected to it, and now everyone that connects to you will be influenced by what influenced you. Have you ever heard someone say, that whole family that is that way? They won't work. They're all just lazy. Why? Because it's been passed on. Negative influence breeds a negative life. On the same hand, positive influences breeds a positive life. Have you ever heard one say, that's such a good family. Every one of them are the most kind and honest people I've ever met. Why? Because it was passed on. Influence is invisible, but it attaches to other people's lives. Flowing into your children's, your friends, your family members. The Apostle Paul said it one day to a group called the Galatians. In Galatians 3:1, he said this very thing. He said, "Oh, foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you that you would stray from life and truth?" He didn't say what has bewitched you. He said who has bewitched you, who has influenced you. In other words, he was asking who you've been hanging out with. Who you been eating with at Colton's? Talk to me. Who got in your head? Who convinced you to believe such stuff? Who encouraged you to get on their bandwagon? Who's breeding this stuff? He was asking, who is the influence? And folks, it happens all the time. You'll start hanging around someone with a negative agenda, and before the meal's over, you're singing the same song as them. No facts to their negative agenda, just assumptions and a personal vendettas. And before it's over, you end up caught up in something you normally wouldn't have been. And the moment the negative conversation started, you should have got up and left and went home. And then find some new friends to hang out with. If not, you become one of them. Because remember, birds of a feather flock together. Remember, Proverbs 13:20, hang out with fools and you will be destroyed. Paul wanted to know and was saying to them, you think it's not affecting you, but I can see it's affecting you by your actions. You're different. Influence is either negative or positive. Guard yourself. Now, I thank God for positive influences because I wouldn't be here today except for me changing who I was hanging out with. Back before Christ changed my life, it was negative influences all the time. I can tell you they weren't positive, folks. I was hanging out with people I shouldn't have been hanging out with. I was hanging out in places I shouldn't have been hanging out in, and I was doing things I shouldn't have been doing. I mean, I give God all the glory for me being here, but I am suggesting to you, had I not got away from the negative bunch I was hanging with, I could have been in danger of falling away from the greatest thing that ever happened in my life, the day I got saved. I knew I had to change friends. And I didn't have to have someone to tell me it either. God put it in my heart to do it. And then I prayed, God, give me some new friends. People get saved, and then they try to go hang out with the old crowd. They won't last too long. Why? Because the negative crowd would influence them to give up. I remember when I first got saved, I was playing in a rock and roll band at that time. I had for about 25 years. And when I told the band I was quitting because I'd given my life to Christ, they were all like, oh, man, you don't have to do that, man. People go to church all the time. You can still play music. I said, no, I can't. I have to quit. I have to leave this crowd because I have to move on with my life. If this is what I desired for my life, they couldn't be my influence. They would have brought me back down. I didn't need to go where they were. I needed them to come where I am. And some of them have through the years. Two of the musicians I used to play with are now worship leaders in churches. Praise God. Amen. You get negative on me, I'm gone, I'm moving on. And after I got saved, God began to put men and women a positive influence into my life. I can look around this room tonight, and I can see Chuck Lambert and Pastor and Jenny, and I can see Chuck Richardson, I can see Bill Marvin. So many of you have made such a positive influence on my life. And I want to say tonight publicly, I thank you for positively influencing my life. I give God praise for you. Folks, it was a choice. I could have chose either way. But I chose the influence that was going to better me, not destroy me. I want to hang out with people who are going where I'm going. Now, here's one for you. It's better to hang out on your own than with the wrong people. Now, that's a hard one for some. Do you know how many people would rather hang out around with somebody or just anybody rather than be alone, regardless how the influence affects their life? I understand loneliness is a real issue. God don't want you lonely, hanging out always on your own, because you're vulnerable when you're alone. But it's better to do, though, until you get connected to the right people. Have you ever seen a new kid in school, being in school, come in pretty straight, but he wants to fit in so bad that he fits in with the bad? Longing for friendship takes the first relationship offered to him. I've seen this all the time in the grocery business, being a store manager. I hired a lot of teenagers throughout those 25 years. And I would hire a young boy or a young girl who would walk in there, and they were so naive, and they're tender-hearted, and they have a great spirit about them. They're good kids, and they go to school, and they get good grades, and they're just good people. But 90 days later, they get tied up with the wrong influence, just one wrong influence. And before you know it, they're acting different, they're talking different, they're dressing different. And I see their lives changing right before my eyes, and I can realize there's been a bad influence in their life. But they wanted to fit in so badly, though, they were willing to just do whatever to fit in and feel like they were part of something. But the same is for men and women longing for relationships. The first one who reaches out or pays attention to them, they connect with them. Instead of waiting for Mr. Right, then they wonder why they've been married 5 times. You want some good, sound, biblical advice? Then I'm going to let the Word of God instruct you right here. These are not going to be my words. Let's read Proverbs 12 and 26, and let's just see if what I'm telling you tonight is right. Proverbs 12, 26 says, "The righteous," say the righteous, "should choose his friends carefully. For the way of the wicked leads them astray." He's saying, be cautious of the friendships you choose. And he's saying, you should choose your friends carefully. It can happen in the church too. Can I tell you, everybody in church isn't here always for the right reasons. Sometimes we've got some creepers you pass through. But because you're wanting to fit in so bad, you don't choose your friends carefully and you end up getting hurt. It can happen, though, folks, in any circle of relationships. Now, there's a difference being friendly and being in a friendship. Friendly, you speak to them, you welcome them, you accommodate them. But in a friendship, you hang out with them, you share, you're connected. And please hear this scripture, the word cautious, carefully. Be friendly with everyone, but be cautious in friendships. Hang out with the wrong crowd and watch your life literally be destroyed. Ever heard the testimony of a lot of convicts? Their most famous line when explaining how they ended up in prison is, "I got mixed up with the wrong crowd. I started hanging out with the wrong bunch. All it takes is one bad influence to change the whole course of your life. I've seen this happen in high school. In high school, in their senior year, we had a work program. You go to school half a day, and then you worked half a day. I was in that program. And then they had a competition, marketing competition. I entered it. And fortunately, I did place and got to go to the Nationals with five other people. Well, we stayed in one room, and the other three stayed in another room. There was a young man who went with us. His name was Brian. Brian was a little different than us. He had a lot of expectations in the life. A very smart young man, had a great career ahead of him. Brian was going to be a lawyer. I was going to sack groceries, and he's going to be a lawyer. But he went with the crowd, too, in his division. Well, that night, the next morning, I got up, and I noticed Brian and another guy were not down at the breakfast table. And I began to ask, where did they go? Where are they at? They said, haven't you heard? I said, no. He said, they got sent home. I said, sent home? What'd they do? Well, Brian happened to be rooming with the young man who introduced him that night for the first time in Brian's life, marijuana. And they were smoking marijuana on the balcony of their room, and the teacher walked in and caught them. And they sent Brian home. It was very devastating to Brian. He had one influence that night that he gave in to, and he tried it, and he got caught, and he went home. Then only for 6 months later, I see where Brian was arrested for possession of marijuana. And I can tell you, Brian never became an attorney. It totally changed the whole course of his life. One bad influence changed that whole young man's life. That's how powerful influence is in our lives. Praise God. So what's the answer to avoid making this mistake? You got to be intentional about hanging out with the right people. You got to make the right decision before you ever get involved. Ask, is this person negative or positive for my life? Will this person enhance my life or help destroy my life? But here's the key. Here's the key to it all. It's before you make this decision, before it ever becomes a friendship, before it ever becomes a relationship, before you ever fall in love with them. Because it's a whole lot easier to walk away then. But once you're connected to the negative influence, it will drive you, bind you, drain you, and eventually it will destroy you. And you'll vow to try and change them, and 99% of the time, they end up changing you. I see this all the time in marriage counseling. People will choose someone who's not who they want, but they think they can make them into who they want. And when it doesn't work, neither does the marriage. I'm always going to be friendly. I love people. But I can tell you, when it comes to friendships or relationships, I'm going to be intentional. Do you know how many lives could be changed, turned around in an instant, if they would make this word only applicable to their lives? That's why this message is more important than you think tonight. Turning your negative influences in for a positive influence will lead you to a victorious life. Some of you can't get victory because your surroundings keep pulling you back down. They don't want you to be better than them. They don't want you to move forward. They don't want you to surpass them. Remember, in their minds, you're in this life together, to fail together if necessary. See, I can still remember today seeing a sign as a teenager that read, "Everybody wants to go to heaven, but I want to go with my friends." Now, how stupid is that relationship? There's people who actually feel that way. Rather die and go to hell with their friends than to lose their friendship that is so toxic that it will destroy their lives. I'm here to tell you, it's not necessary to fail. It's a choice that is driven by negative influence. And sometimes to survive, you have to cut some people loose. I had to. When I told you about when I was playing the band, I had to cut them loose. It didn't mean I didn't like them anymore. I just knew I couldn't hang around with them anymore. The negative influence is always telling you you'll never make it, you're no good, you're not strong enough, you're not smart enough, you're not rich enough. But I've come to tell you that you can do all things through Christ who does strengthen you. That's the influence you need. Someone speaking truth into your life. Someone that's for you and not against you. It was Jesus who said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. Who said, I will stick with you closer than a brother. Said he's for you and he's not against you. Says you're a pearl of great price. Says his thoughts toward you are not of evil, but they're of good and of peace. That's the friend you need. That's the relationship you need. That's the one you need to truly fall in love with. Some people say, I don't have no friends. Well, the Bible says in order to have friends, you must show yourself friendly. Now, some of you got friends, but the wrong ones. And some of you with friends like you got, you don't need no enemies. Kevin Gerald put out a book wrote called Design or Default. And he talks about being intentional in your decision-making. It'll help you to make the right decisions. Because when you're not, you'll simply default, meaning you ought to choose your relationships, not just fall into them due to circumstances. Relationships ought to be built by design. They ought to be intentional. If not, you will just default to building them out of convenience, building them out of peer pressure, building them out of circumstances, out of emotions, such as loneliness. And we often get caught in traps in life. We want to make other people happy, and we do things to win their approval. We compromise our values to fit in. We need to be needed. Ask yourself, did you pick your friends, or did you just fall into the friendship by living next door to them? Because you worked together, or because you had class together? And how many of you could say, well, I met him or her one day, I really didn't have anyone to hang out with, and now after a period of time, are you more like them than you were when you first met them? If it's a positive influence, that's a good thing. But if it's been a negative influence, that's a bad thing. You used to go to church, but he don't, now you don't. You used to not drink, now you both do. You used to help in ministry, now neither one of you do. Some people are not good for each other. They have toxic relationships, and they get each other into trouble. Instead of choosing to only build friendships that would bring positive changes to your life, you allow negative changes to come by default instead of by design. Send a kid to college to be a doctor, but he gets with the wrong crowd. Now he works simply on the assembly line of a factory. Now, there's nothing wrong with working on an assembly line in a factory, except for the fact when you're called to do so much more, and the only thing that stopped it was one, one negative influence. Simply hungry for love. You got to looking for love in all the wrong places. Instead of just hanging out with people, why not start looking for the people God is trying to place in your life? Be guided by a sense of purpose. Be intentional. Everybody's not going where you want to go, but somebody is. Get connected with them. Be intentional. Don't say you want to live a godly lifestyle and then hang out with the devil's brother or Satan's sister. If you want to hang out in God's house and he wants to hang out in the crack house, it ain't going to work. God wants you to have a travel companion in your life. But you got to first ask yourself, where do you want to go and where do they want to go? Don't get on flight 62 to Utah if you're wanting to go to West Virginia. You get on the wrong flight, it's going to take you where you never intended to go. You got to find people headed in the right direction, because oil and water does not mix. And God puts people in our lives, and how we treat them determines how God can work in our lives. You may have never seen me before, but just maybe God is putting me in your life today. Just maybe there are some people around you tonight in this room that God has planned for you to connect with. But the question is, do we recognize when God puts people in our lives? Because if we don't recognize it, they don't stay in our lives very long. People look for God in all the wrong places. Do you know how many times God has tried to put people in our lives? And many times God shows up in our lives through people. For Joseph, while in prison, he showed up in a baker and a cupbearer. They were the link, the connection to Joseph meeting Pharaoh and getting out of prison. For Paul, he showed up in Timothy, and for Timothy, he showed up in Paul. For Naomi and Ruth, God showed up in one another. And for Jonathan and David, God put them together. And there are God-assigned connections in every one of your lives, and you've got to connect with them. You've got to look for them. And one of the best places you can hang out is with other believers. If you're a believer, hang out with believers. Don't be unequally yoked. If people only see church as a place to attend, then they'll never truly receive the complete benefits God has planned for their lives. And as long as church is just a place to attend, they limit the potential of what God wants to do in their lives through the church. If you just come in here and leave, you'll never receive the full benefits. Here's why. The church is not just a place to attend. It is a community to belong to. Church is about people. Not about the things we do, but about the people who do the things. It's not supposed to be like going to a nice restaurant where you enjoyed the service and the food was good. And you get up and walk out and say, that was nice. Every believer belongs in a church. There's godly benefits to it. You need to be planted in the house of God. That's where God surrounds us with the relationships that will strengthen our lives. And that's why he said, forsake not the assembling of the saints. God knows it's where you will be strengthened, encouraged, equipped, loved, healed, discipled. This is where positive influence is found. We need each other because as believers, God works through us to help us help each other, to help us meet one another's needs. His power works through us. He said he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above anything we're able to ask, I think, by the power that works in us. So if you're a believer, you can't have the mindset it's just a place to attend. It's not like going to the movies or to a restaurant. This is a place to fellowship and connect and find positive relationships. It is a place to belong. So when you come in here with the expectation you can connect with the right people, where God can flow to you and God can flow through you. It's going to happen through you when you connect. Remember, what you connect to flows through you. Many say, I can't get connected. That's not true. You need to check your mindset. It's about connecting with those around you. It's not just about whether you connect with the pastor or a certain clique. It's about connecting with the ones God has placed in your life. There's times we've had people come in and they meet 10 people and they say they never connected because they didn't become best friends with a certain leader. We need to connect in small groups and then come together and draw from one another. And here's what I believe. We are here for one another to mess up the enemy's plan. That when the thief comes into our lives, there is a protective mechanism that is going on around our lives and is called the church. See, most people underestimate the influence of the choices that we make every single day of our lives. And the choices we make every day not only affect us, but they also affect those around us and those to come. Then they will even affect the generations to come. Decisions that are made in the church today, decisions that are made in politics today, decisions that are made in the homes today, will affect the generations to come. And you may not know this, but the Bible says that the iniquity or sin, the sins of the fathers, are passed down to the third and fourth generations. So sin in a father's life, sinful ways and habits, negativity, state of mind, and addictions, those kinds of things can be passed down to your children to the third and the fourth generation. I didn't make this up. This is in the Bible. I'm trying to raise awareness tonight to help us understand the power of choices in our lives and how it's impacting the people who are coming after you. Do you know the stats say that the average life, your average life, you will influence 10,000 people, negative or positive? And the question I have today is whether or not what came to us is going to continue to flow through us. Your negative influence that you've received from those before you, those things that have been detrimental to your life, are you going to just keep passing them things through, or are you going to commit to saying, it stops with you? Will you be that link that chooses to reconnect to the right things? Are you going to be the one who says, I'm not passing this on to the next ones? And the question is, are you going to allow what was in your past to also continue in your future? Because there is no excuse for it to. You have the power to change things. They don't have to be like they've always been. And the change begins with making right choices. Well, I can't help how I am. Yes, you can. I can't quit going down that road. Yes, you can. Turn around. I can't quit gossiping. I can't quit cussing. I can't find friends. Yes, you can. And tonight, I want to give us the opportunity to ponder and consider the reality that you could be the beginning of a new thing. You could be the one. You could be the link in the change that changes all the links for the years to come. See, my two brothers, they quit school. I didn't. I decided to change the link. You can be the one who changes things. You can pioneer change. And I want to remind you what your parents did, if they were of a negative influence, you don't have to do. The things we don't overcome, the issues we leave on the table, so to speak, are the things that we pass down for the next generation to deal with. And too many times we are deceived to believe it's easier to accept than change, to endure than fight. And we convince ourselves we deserve the despair. But that's a trap of the enemy. It's a lie of the devil. You can be the one to change it. There's story after story that has been told, and you've heard them all, of a man or a woman who, against all odds, from a detestable social conditions, rose above it all and excelled, broke records, made history, and even became national role models. It's not because someone came by and handed it to them on a silver platter. No, they made right choices and were determined to be different, and they paid the price to achieve. Therefore, opening a new door to those who follow them. See, it's always harder for the first one to change, but after doing so, it opens doors for those who follow you. You can be the one. Instead of being in prison, you could be the warden of the prison. Instead of being a thief, you could be the judge. Instead of being a liar, you could be a preacher. Instead of being a drug addict, you could be the one running the drug treatment center. My point is, instead of being cursed, you can be blessed. Instead of the curser, you can be the blesser. Instead of being the problem, you can be the solution. Because you can choose blessing or cursing. And God said it's a choice that you choose. And you choose by what you sow, because you reap what you sow. Your choices are like seed, either good seed or bad seed. Bad choice produces bad results. Positive choices produce positive things. You say, I can't help it. There's your seed. I can't. When you need to plant some, I can. Influence is a powerful thing. Who is influencing you? It's time to walk with the wise so you can become wise too. And it's time to quit being a companion to fools so your life won't be destroyed. And I believe it's time for you to reevaluate your life, and this time be intentional in your decision making and build your life by design, not by default. You as a Christian are to be a conqueror. And if you're not, and you feel defeated, then I ask you, who is influencing you? Now, I've spent a lot of time talking about who has or is influencing you, and I've warned you of the pitfalls of negative influences. But now let me get real with you for just a moment. regardless of all those before you, regardless of all the influences, all the bad influence prior to you being born, it's time for you to take the responsibility and say that from this point on, everything that passes through me will no longer be a negative influence, but I am determined to be a positive influence for those who follow me, my children, my grandchildren, my friends, my fellow workers, all of those people that I connect to from this point on in my life, regardless of what happened before, I don't no longer have to let that pass through me. I can be the link that from this day forward, I begin to change my influence in those who follow me. Because as I told you before, every single one of us have been influenced, but every single one of us is also an influencer. And you have to ask yourself, what kind of influence are you passing on to those who are going to follow you? Because there's a lot of people following you. If you're in leadership, people are following you. If you manage the factory, people are following you. If you have friends, people are following you. And it's time to take responsibility and ask, are you a positive or a negative influence to those who are connecting to you? It's just like this weekend, we had a lot of ladies who went to Branson. A lot of them are gone. But they went this weekend and sat under a positive influence. There was a minister who ministered to them positive things, spoke into their lives, encouraged them. That's what ministers do. Now they're encouraged, though. Now they've heard positivity in their life. And maybe for a lot of them, they decided that from this day on, I'm not going to be a link that passes on all the negativity anymore. And from now on, I'm going to be a positive person who passes on positive things. And they got their minds all made up. And then they bonded with people. They've stayed in rooms. That's how it goes in those things. You bond with people. You get to know each other. And they find people. They connect with people all weekend long. People maybe they never even met before, and they're connecting. And all those 400 people have bonded. But here's the thing. Then they come home. And here's where it's very crucial. Who they come home and reconnect with. If they come back and connect to negativity, it won't be long and everything that was put into them will be out of them. They have got to come back and be the positive influence. And if it means cutting some people loose to keep what they found, the joy that God has given them, and the positive outlook on life they now have, then it must be done so. And sometimes those are some of the closest people to you. Because that friendship or that relationship you got into with them anyway was not done by design. It was done by default. And you just connected one day. And now, what the difference is now, they come back, they have the positive influence, they have to come back and they have to begin to change those people that follow them. They have to now be the positive influence because they have been influenced positively. But they can't come back and hang around a bunch of negative people or they'll be drained. And everything that they gained, the seed that they got planted in their hearts, will be stolen by the enemy. Bad influences leads to temptation. The very thing the pastor preached on this morning. You have bad influences in your life, I promise you it will lead to temptations in your life. Influence is invisible. And it's a powerful current that flows to you and it flows through you. The musicians would come at this time, and I'd like to ask you to stand, if you would, please. I told you I wasn't going to be real long. I don't think I have been. I maybe finally kept my word for once. Praise the Lord. But this is life. It's just like a chain. And you're a link in your life. When you were born, you connected to people. And they influence. They put things in your life, whether good or bad. If you were raised by a good influence, you need to praise God every day that you had good influences in your life. You were blessed. But for some, they weren't. But that doesn't mean it has to continue through your life, down through the third and fourth generation of your life. You can change this thing. You can be the link that breaks the chain and reconnects to positive things. And if you struggle with your Christianity and being a believer, and you struggle in life and you're always finding yourself falling or having setbacks in your life, like I said, this is an invisible current that sometimes we overlook. You need to check your surroundings. You need to check who you're hanging out with. And if all you hear is negative stuff from them, there's your sign. You'll never have a positive outlook on life hanging around with a negative influence. And it's your place as a Christian to change the dynamics of your life by becoming you yourself. Quit blaming everybody else, because now you're the influencer. You don't live with mom and dad no more. You're an adult. Now you have a choice to make. Do you become a positive influencer or a negative influencer? Because you're influencing people every day of your life. People are watching you, and you don't even realize some of them are watching you. And what you do as a Christian, what you portray, people look at it. And sadly, for many, have been turned off by Christianity because of how you act in front of people. You're negative. You're never positive. Your actions don't speak right. And people are watching us. So we have a responsibility that we have to try to come to a place and commit our lives to, and saying, from this point on, the people that follow me, I want to influence them positively. Young people, there's several young people that are here tonight. I'm glad you're here tonight to hear this message. Because you're growing up in your life and you're living under influences in your life. Some have been good. Maybe for some of you, you're blessed. Some of you, it's been negative. But the people you hang around with can change your whole life. One bad influence can change the course of your life to being something that God intended for your life, to becoming something God never intended for your life to be. So if you're going to have friends, choose your friends. Don't let them choose you. You see good, godly people, say, I choose to be a friend of that person. That person's going where I'm going. That's who you have to connect with. I want to take some time now, and I want us to pray. I don't feel really led to have an altar call with you, but I do want to pray with you. And I want you to pray. I want you to pray these things. I want you to pray to commit to change for the sake of those who are following you. Every single person here has got people following you. If your attitude's not right, if your influence is negative, commit to changing, to having a positive influence for those who are coming after you. It's one of the things I want you to pray. Then I want you to pray for God to put good influences into your life. Be intentional about this thing. Pray intentionally, God, put people in my life. Positive role models, positive friends. And then I want you to pray for those who follow you, your children and your grandchildren. Pray that you will be the influence they need in their life. And if you're struggling with your Christian walk, I want to also encourage you to pray tonight and ask God to forgive you, and ask God to help you and lead you to the right people. Let us pray together. Father, I come to you tonight in the precious name of Jesus Christ. We've heard your word tonight, Father. I thank you for speaking to our lives. I thank you for speaking to my life about the importance of influence, that how powerful influence is in our life, God. That the things we've been raised under and the things we've learned, God, for some of us, we had positive influences. For some of us, we didn't have good influences. But, Father, I've come to realize, though, that I've come to a place in my life that we have to have a decision that we must make and a responsibility we must make ourselves, Father, that we realize that we are influencers, too, and that we cannot allow negative influences to continue to pass through our lives, that we must make a fresh commitment tonight, dear God, and commit our lives to saying, from this day forward, I am a link in the chain of my life, and I am going, for those who follow me, I'm committing to be a positive influence. That I'm no longer going to speak negative things. I'm no longer going to have a negative attitude, God. But I'm going to try to be that one you want me to be, God, an encourager. That I'm going to speak life. That I'm going to speak blessing and not cursing over my family, my friends, and those who follow me, Father. That I'm not going to be a part of the problem no more, God. That I'm going to bend to be a part of the solution, Father. Father, I pray over every single person in this place tonight. Father, who might be struggling in their relationships. I pray, God, you give them the courage to look at their lives and evaluate who they're hanging out with and help them to understand they're just not hanging out, that as they spend time with those of negative influences, it can alter our lives. It can change the direction, the courses of life. One bad influence can take us off the path that you've prepared for our lives, God. And I pray tonight, dear God, that we'll all realize that we must choose our friendships carefully. Why? Because you thought it was important enough. You put it in the Word of God to instruct us that we should choose our friendships carefully. That we should yoke up with those that are like faith, God, with other believers. That we're not to be unequally yoked, dear God. That if we want to truly experience the true blessings of being a believer, God, then we must surround our lives with other believers. We must have koinonia and fellowship with one another, Father. And God, I just pray tonight, dear God, that for every single one of our lives, God, you continue to direct us and instruct us. I thank you for your word, God, that reproves and brings correction and instruction for righteousness to our lives. We take your word to heart tonight, dear God, and we pray, Father, that we will become the influence we need to be so that with the gospel of Jesus Christ, we can influence this world, Father, and we give you praise for it in Christ's holy name. And everybody said, amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.
That's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips.